Welcome to Deep Dives into the Bible, where we take our time and go deeply into God's Word. I am Father Michael Nasser from St. Nicholas Orthodox Church in Grand Rapids, Michigan. We are here with members of our St. Nicholas family and happy you've joined us. Here's today's conversation. All right. Good to be with you all for Bible study. Begin with prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Illumine our hearts, O Master, who lovest mankind as the pure light of the divine knowledge, and open the eyes of our mind to the understanding of the gospel teachings. Implant in us also the fear of thy blessed commandments, that trampling down all carnal desires, we may enter upon a spiritual manner of living, both thinking and doing such things as are well pleasing unto thee. For thou art the illumination of our souls and bodies of Christ our God, thee we send up glory, together with thy Father, who is from everlasting, and that all holy and good and life giving spirit, now and ever to the ages of ages.
Amen.
All right. Carol, you're live. Yay. Oh, nice.
I just didn't know you were like that.
So we are finishing up
Father.
Did we just lose them?
I think so.
Yeah, I'm going to go let them know.
Thanks, Jerry.
Father Michael, can you hear us?
I can hear you. I can't hear the room, but I can hear everybody else.
Stay here.
I said Father Michael, not. That's okay.
Unless you were ordained, since we last saw
you. No. Probably wouldn't be a good choice.
I stepped away. Where did he say we were? Matthew, what, 25?
Yeah, just beginning of 25.
We're working on it.
Yeah, it's dying. Do we have? We had another one of these. Some the old ones.
Let me go check with you.
Oh, we can hear you now.
We can hear you.
We can hear you.
Yeah, until this thing dies, it's about to die.
Start singing God grant you many.
There were two more.
God grant you many minutes.
Yeah. We're gonna pause the recording for a second. We don't have to be bored too much of this stuff. All right, had a little technical difficulties there. So let's restart a little bit. Matthew 25 is in many ways a very pivotal chapter. It's the end of the story until the passion narrative, which is going to be the passion, the crucifixion, resurrection, will be the climax of the story as Matthew tells it. And this is where it all ends up before then. And so there's a lot of in many ways, summary of what we've heard up to this point, at least in terms of Jesus' teaching. And if you remember way back when, happy 100th anniversary, everybody. This is our 100th episode on the Gospel of Matthew. So 100 episodes ago, we talked about the fact that there would be 5 long discourses.
Only five
in the Gospel. This is the 5th. Anybody remember what the first was?
Sermon on the Mount.
There you go. So that was the first. There were several in between, and this is now the final one. So this is Jesus's really his final long teaching until we get to the passion, crucifixion, and resurrection. So there's a lot of it here that really is critical to and sort of includes everything that precedes it and is going to point to the ending. So last time we were together, we looked at the parable of the 10 virgins. And what was the summary teaching that we came to after a lot of hard work?
Be prepared
for
Christ's return, because we do not know when it will be.
What do we know about it? We don't know when, but what do we know?
It is going to happen.
It's going to happen, and when is it going to happen?
Late.
Later than everyone expects. Okay, so
like
the whole...
late in the day or late, like our time, because nobody expected it to be this long.
Exactly. It was late then, so yeah. So
our babysitter when we were young was very Christian Reformed, and she did not believe in going to the movie theater, because if Christ came again, she didn't want to be caught in the movie theater.
All right. And depending what you're watching, I could see that was probably a wise thing to do. So he's going to become prepare in a way that includes him coming later than expected. And now you're going to see how that same theme is going to go repeated again, but with some variation in the teaching in this one. So who would read for us the parable of the talents? This is in 25, verses 14 to 30. Any volunteers?
I can read.
Thank you.
14 to 30. Hold on a minute. There we go. We must be good stewards. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country, who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his own ability. And immediately he went on a journey. Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more also. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So he who had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. He also, who had received 2 talents, came and said, Lord, you have delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents beside them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. But his Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming, I would have received back my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have abundance. But from him who does not have, even what he will be taken away. And cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Peace be to thee, Peters.
All right, so let's look at this at different levels. We'll take it at the story level first. Forget the meaning for a moment. Let's just understand the story, because it's a parable. A parable is a story that has a teaching to it. Let's make sure we understand the story. So somebody summarize for us what's going on in this story.
A wealthy man, one would assume, with much property,
mm-hmm.
went to his holdings and visited his managers and gave them various resources. And then he went away, and the two of the managers doubled their resources, mm-hmm. and one buried it, and the two were given more, and the one was harshly criticized. What he had was taken away.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's to everyone who has more will be given.
Yeah, so that's going to get to the teach. We'll get ahead of a second. So good. Good summary. Everybody follows the flow. You've got somebody who has a lot. We've had this before. We've had banquets with kings and rulers. And so same theme gets repeated. And Kathy noted the important piece in this one, which is in many of them, he goes away. It's a little bit different in the last parable. In that one, the bridegroom hadn't come yet, but he was away. And he's expecting, rightly, that certain people I was away would do certain things, that when he returns, certain things happen. So you're going to see the similarities. What he gives away, actually doesn't give it away, what he lends to them or what he transfers to them, does he give it away? Does he say, here, you can have five, you can have two, you can have one, it's yours, do with what you want? Is that what he's doing?
No.
So what's he doing?
It was still his, and they wanted to, he wanted each of them to be the caregiver of the amount that was given to them.
Right. Okay. So something already, and if we're going to think with an ear back to the parable of the 10 virgins, you can start to fill in some gaps on some of the questions. What he expects them to use is not of their own. He didn't say, make some money on your own and then do it. He's here, it is what is mine. He's not giving it away. He's saying, I'm going to entrust this to you, and I'm going to expect you're going to do something with it. Now, he does he say what he wants them to do? He doesn't say it, but what's the implication by the expectation when he returns?
That they had done something with it.
Done something with it, and done something to
increase
it. That's the good way, right?
Yeah.
That they would have done something with it.
I don't see that anywhere. Does he specify what he wants?
No.
Oh.
But I want to make sure we understand from the story that when he comes back, it's not, they don't ask him, what did you want us to do?
Oh, right? Oh, I see. Yeah.
So we got to look at the whole alternate to fill in the story here. They knew that when he came back, he was going to expect something from them. Right. And mm-hmm. the two that are rewarded did what he wanted. Now, he didn't say necessarily double it, but each one did. And then the other one gives him back what he was given, and that was obviously not considered good enough, right? Because what could he have done?
He could have at least given it to the bankers to at least have increased it with some interest.
With something, okay? Yeah. So therefore,
not only did he not do anything with it, he criticized his master and said, because you were such a hard guy, I was afraid.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to make sure you got at least that back.
Yes. So the two had different expectations. The master, and we don't hear the correction, right? Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not winnow. All right. So he understands his master to do what? To expect them to do something where the increase is not from the master's work. All right. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So the master says, here's my five, here's my two, here's my one. And the master, well, they all understood that he's going to reap where he does not sow. You all understand what that means?
No.
So the master, according to the I don't know, does he call him the wicked servant? What does he call him?
Yeah.
Christ
can be mean sometime in the wording that he uses. He called him wicked and lazy.
So is that mean Or is this parable helping us understand something that we're going to have to wrestle with? And that is that, and we'll get to the teaching part later. We should make sure that story. The master is a hard man.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And he's hard in the sense of what? That he's going to reap where he has not sown. In other words, he wants to gather the harvest from seeds that he's not planting.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The master isn't planting the 5, 2, and the 1. He's giving it to the, as Kathy said, the managers. You guys go and you plant this. And the expectation is when he comes back, he wants what he loaned them, in a sense, what he entrusted to them. And he wants to reap from their work.
And they don't know when he's coming back.
No.
So.
Right.
That sounds familiar.
So he's saying to us, I'm giving you the faith, and it's up to you now to grow it. I'm giving you the basics of whatever it might be, if it's the church or the faith or whatever. And he says, now you have to make it multiply.
Yes.
You have to bring in the catechumens.
Whatever it is, and we haven't defined it. And in fact, I don't think we're going to be able to define it by the end. But whatever the it is, whatever the talent is, it should be multiplied. Now, remember, talent here is not like I can juggle or I'm a good salesperson. Exactly.
It was
right?
Money.
It's a weight, yeah. Right? It's a weight of precious metal that has value to it, right? And it's a lot, right? I forget. Any of you have a footnote on how much a talent is? Mine says 15 years of wages.
Oh, wow, for one talent, wow.
That's a lot.
Yeah, I've heard in other places it's like the equivalent of about 2 pounds. So think about, 2 pounds of gold or silver. That's a lot of precious metal.
If they're his servants, do they get paid?
We assume that, they're taking, right. Now, at that point, servants, the word here, servant, we also can translate slave, and this we have to be careful. In our American context, slavery was a very cruel institution. Slavery historically wasn't always necessarily cruel. It was actually something that was very healthy when it was done properly, because we've talked about the relationship between master and servant. The servant does have responsibilities. He does what the master tells him to do. The master has responsibilities for the servants, which is to provide for their every need. One of the examples I've used is, for those of you that watched, Downton Abbey, it's a coming into the modern day where still there are servants around, and there's sort of the extended community around the estate. And you hear a lot of the dialogue of the responsibility felt by the family to care for all those that were employed.
Mm-hmm.
So from different times in the story, it's, well, what's best also for the staff and their families and the town. So yes, he gets paid, the servants get paid, but the payment isn't necessarily like we think, like you get a salary and you go home. Instead, the servants are taken care of by the master.
Father, here it says a talent is a great sum of money. It represents the goodness God has bestowed on each person.
Okay. So whatever it is, Alan gave us a couple of possibilities. Right, what it could be, he's not defining it, but it's something of value.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever that happens to be, we'll get into some of the possibilities in a minute. The expectation is, while the master is away, the servant's supposed to take it and do something with it that brings the master gain from the work of the servants. Right? Mm-hmm. So in other words, giving him back what he gave you is not sufficient. Which is where we get to the problem with the third one. We'll get there in a minute. All right, let's go back to the fact that he gives 3 different servants 3 different amounts. Is there any meaning in that?
We are all given different gifts.
Yeah, and that's normal.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yep.
The story is not, I gave 1, 5, I gave 1, 2, I gave 1, 1. And the 4th servant said, wait a minute, I didn't get any. How come he got more than me? Everybody is given different amounts, and what they're expected to produce is in proportion to what they were given, right? The servant that was given to, he made two, and the message to him is the same as the message one made five. He didn't say, well, that guy made five, you only made two. So there's a proportional idea of, here's what I gave you, and I'm going to expect you to do with what I gave you, in proportion to that, you should produce something. Now, he's a hard man, right, according to the story. But let's go to the third servant. What was insufficient that the third servant did or didn't do?
He didn't do anything to increase it. He did what he thought was right to at least save that amount.
Right.
So that he wouldn't lose any of it.
Right. And the implication is, you ought to have invested money with the bankers, and am I coming, I should free what I'm owed with interest, all right? The implication, though, is not that you would, that would have doubled, right? To double an investment is a long, 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 but there is increase, there's interest.
Mm-hmm.
And so even though he's a hard man, which again, we're not going to, it's not, the story doesn't dispute it, he does expect growth from what he's entrusted. It's not necessarily a doubling, but you got to do something. Even something easy. Take it down to the bank and tell them, I'm going to come back for the interest when my master comes back. So here's the question. We're going to get finishing the story. Now we'll get to the meaning. Is the master a hard man?
Yes.
Why would you say yes?
He was successful, and when he told people to do stuff, they did it, and he expected that out of the managers.
Mm-hmm.
And if he gave them something, he expected them to handle it, and they knew him well enough that they couldn't just give back the amount that he gave.
Okay, so good argument for the fact that he's a hard man. Again, the story is not going to dispute that. In what ways is he not a hard
man? Well, he implies that he would have been, I don't know if happy is the right word, but he would have been satisfied with a minimal effort of putting the money in the bank.
Mm-hmm.
And taking, you know, whatever a little bit of interest he
right.
could have gotten. But he also rewarded the one that had the three talents, because we don't know whether he gave him all 10 talents or just the one from the servant that was only given one talent. To just give that one to the one that has 10 talents.
Oh, at the end, you mean?
Yeah.
So the one that has the 10.
Now has 11.
Right. But how did he get to 10?
He doubled.
Right.
He doubled what was given
to him.
Master's
5, he doubled it. Now he's at his 10. So.
The servant, the gentleman that got only one talent, he didn't try. You know, if the people that got 5 and 10, at least they tried. If they didn't right. increase their talent, at least they made the effort. The single man, the one with only one, didn't even try.
Right.
He had a scarcity mentality. He was afraid he was going to lose it, you know, and so yep. that fear probably kind of just took over. I don't want to lose this. I gotta hang on to it. Maybe yeah. I don't know.
So the story doesn't dispute the guy's characterization. He's a hard man. But I think we can make the argument both ways, right? He does expect. You can't turn in nothing. But what he expects in some ways is so minimal that, okay, well, if you turn in, if you just take it to the bank, drop it off, that would have been good with me. So I want to make sure we get the story right, because then we're going to have to now look at what he's saying. Any other questions on the story and how it works?
Nope.
All right. So there's an ending here that we didn't talk about yet with the story. When the master comes back and when they bring their what they've produced, what's the result? What does the master do with what he entrusted them with?
He honors them. He gives them, I'm going to let you be responsible for even more now because I can trust you and And he did it with both of the two that doubled their...
Yeah.
Their...
And therefore, who ends up with it? It's a trick question.
Well, we know that... I think it's the master.
But so in some ways, it's the master, right? Because it's his stuff, and he wanted the produce, and he expects the reaping of what he didn't sow. And the servant presents it. Well done, good and faithful servant. In that way, it's the master's. In what way is it not the master's? Look at... let's see. Look at verses 28 and 29.
Well, the servant that was given the one talent that didn't increase it at all, that was taken away from him,
mm-hmm.
and he was cast out. He wasn't going to be welcome yep. there any longer, and they gave it to the one that had now 10 talents.
So who's 10, now 11 talents is that?
I don't know. I know the one belongs to the guy, to the man, but...
Well, they all originally did, right?
They're still servants that's going back to the master.
Okay, except, and I agree with you, except...
The one?
Look at 28 and 29.
Because he will have abundance. So the actual person who invested it and got more, he was the one who was blessed.
So in both cases, he says, this is what you earned. I put you over little. Now I'm going to put you over much. Whose is it? It's not clear.
Well, you could think it's still the master's, but the one that had doubled his and had 10, now it's going to have credit for 11.
Right. And that sort of lack of clarity of whose is it, because he says in 29, give it to him. Now, is it giving him the responsible? That's the implication. But my point is, whose that is unclear. Because he's given it to do something with it. Then he says, now give it to him.
Well, I'm going to push back on that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I think the talent is still the master's,
mm-hmm.
and it seems like there's some other reward for being the overseer of more.
Yeah, and I'm not really concerned with sort of whose name is on the title, but when he says, so take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10, give it to him now.
You know, it's interesting, Father, from an investment perspective, no one got a better return. The five got five more, that's 100% return. The two got two, that's 100% return.
Yep.
It's not like they were being, oh, this one's a better investor and got a better return. It was just the one that didn't do anything at all.
Right. Yep.
Does that play into the picture or not at all? Does that play into the story or not?
Well, we'd have to imply it doesn't say it, but I think the implication is, in some ways, well, he's saying it clearly, to everyone who has, will more be given, and he'll have abundance. So was it, we can guess, is it that one with the five gambled more in the sense that the gambling was what the one with the one didn't want to gamble. He wanted to risk it, stick it in the ground. The one that went and worked with the five had five times more to risk, or had 2.5 times more than the one with the two to risk. But that's just a guess. I think what's clear, though, is that what we are given, what in the story, what they were given to do, they're going to reap the reward. It may not be their name on the title, right? I don't think that's relevant. What is clear is that they benefit. It's not just, okay, you gave me five, I made five more, here you go, and that person is now at the same state they were before, right? What does he say to the one with the five? Verse 21.
and turn to the joy of your Lord.
All right. Now we can extrapolate. What does that mean? But whatever it is, it's really good. You're in the joy of your Lord. He has the ability to reward you with abundance, as we're going to see down in 29. So the point I want to make sure we get from the story is, yes, the master is a hard man in some ways. Yes, he has expectations. But the story is not just about how the master benefits. That's the part I want to make sure we don't miss. The servants are going to benefit, or if they don't do what they're supposed to do, they're going to suffer based on their choices. It's not just what the master gains and loses. Does it make sense? I think it's a key understanding that if we don't get it, we end up, when we try to now interpret the story, we're going to interpret it in the wrong way. We have to understand how the story works. All right. So any question on the story level?
I have something.
Please.
Father, my take is being reminded it's not mine to keep.
Good.
I forget whose it is.
Yes.
That they're God's, or we are.
Yep.
God.
Yeah. And in the story, again, remember, a servant really doesn't have anything other than what the master provides. And a good master provides everything that the servant needs. And in this story, this master, even though we don't call him a good master, we call him a hard man, he rewards with abundance the people that take his servants, that take what they were entrusted to do and do at least a minimal amount with it, they get rewarded.
Father, tell me what the talent was again. I'm sorry, was it 2 pounds of gold, you said, approximately?
I've read that somewhere else. I don't remember that. That's kind of my memory of it. But my footnote says 15 years worth of wages.
Okay, 15. All right. Thank you.
In verse 15, he says, to each according to his own ability. So he didn't give them, expect more from. He expected more from the 5 and the 10 and maybe less from the 1. But he doesn't give you more than you are able to handle.
Right. Based on, as you're rightly pointing out, the ability, each according to his ability.
Yeah.
But the surprising thing is for the guy who was faithful with all 5 of his talents, he was surprised by even additional talent beyond what he had already multiplied.
Right. Could you all hear Carolyn?
Yep. Yes.
Good.
It's a little muffly.
Yeah, she's at the non-mic edge of the table. But yeah, she makes a good point that it's by ability, but that ability then gets not the ability, but the gifting, the talent gets transferred more so, or it gets transferred to the ones who have shown their ability and do something with it, right? And that's where we get the phrase, to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have abundance, but from him who has not, what he has will be taken away.
So, Father, is that saying that the one with the one talent did not use his ability? He
right.
had the ability, but he didn't use it?
Exactly. Even if that ability was just, let me take it to the bank, there's no risk of loss, it's just an investment, and like, it's not stocks, it's bonds. Is that right, Rob?
That's right.
Okay. See, I listen and learn too.
It kind of worked too, because he buried it in the ground.
What do you think? Why do you think that's significant?
I don't know, but it seems like that means something.
Yeah.
It seems like he despises it.
Right? It's not respectful.
It's not respectful.
You don't lock it in the safe.
Good.
You don't put it
in the other room in the house or something.
Yeah, so let's conjecture a little bit. Burying the ground. What could it mean?
His heart is not in the right place.
I feel really bad about something. Because when we first moved here, we got this telemarketing call from this person from Chapel Hill trying to sell us burial plots. And we bought like a burial plot even before we had a house. We knew where we were going to be buried.
Good.
And it was a special deal because we were going to get four really for the price of one, because or two, because our kids, if they had passed before 21, they would have been able to be buried easier too. We thought, well, that's sounds like a pretty good deal, you know. But so we bought this burial plot and we put it in the ground basically. For all these years, we've had that burial plot. We've not died. None of us needed it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking, oh my, are we the ones that just bury? I mean, maybe we should have put that money into like a savings instead of burying it into the ground.
All right.
It was a literal burial.
All right. So this is a good, it's a good test case for.
No, you saved your kids a lot of trouble.
Right. Okay. Because you could, if you just say, well, he buried it in the ground and that's just wasting it because it's in the ground. Every scripture, especially parables, we're going to apply it to a real situation, right? Had you not done that, and God forbid you had died, what would be the result of that? Your kids would have had to deal
with.
They
would have had to pay for.
Had you not done that, they would have paid
right
a whole lot more.
Yeah,
a lot. When I was home last year or so, my mom has been obsessed with all her interview arrangements. That's all she wants to talk about. She's very upset, by the way, that she cannot prepay the mercy meal. So that's another story. So we went to the cemetery and we had to look up all the records. When my father passed, thank God the priest advised her to buy not one, but two plots.
Yeah.
She paid $1,000 for her plot. Guess how much that plot would cost last year?
What,
5,000? Yeah, probably 5,000.
$24,000.
Oh, my.
What a great return.
So,
she done good.
She done good, right?
Is it oceanfront real estate or something?
No. California, it all might be oceanfront someday. You never know.
Yeah.
Exactly. It was California, but it was also a number of years ago, too, Father. I don't know if people know your father passed away so early.
Right. A long time ago. 50 years this year. But so that's how you take it. And you is that example? No. You actually invested as a way to avoid a higher cost and even more so for your kids. So it's a good test case for that. All right. So let's go back to burying the ground. I think Sue's right. I think this is important. It's not respectful. It's an act of fear, right? That's why he's doing it. There's a nothingness to it, right? Just put it in the ground. Don't do anything with it. What else? Anything else we can get out of that?
Hide it.
Okay.
Well, that just made me think when my dad's sister had been married for about 25 years and then she divorced her husband. And Uncle George was always a part of everything, even after they were divorced. But because he had to pay her alimony, he took a lot of his money and put it in jars and buried it all over his yard so that she couldn't get her hands on it. And a few times over the years after he passed, somebody was digging a hole or something other than all of the money.
I think I might go get a metal detector. Give me the address.
There's a real contempt there, isn't there?
Yeah. Yeah, it's an act of fear. Master, I knew you to be a hard man. Let's see, I just lost it.
I mean, fear can certainly stop you in your tracks. I mean, we've probably all experienced fear at some time in our life, and you don't always make the right decision. Matter of fact, you usually don't.
Yep. I was talking to somebody recently in a confession, and they were talking about how they had a genuine fear of the judgment, which on one hand is maybe a healthy thing to have to a certain degree, but it's also good when we apply what we learn from the scriptures that not everyone is going to be asked to produce five talents, right? It's according to the gift, according to the investment, according to the talent of the person, and even though he's a hard man because he wants something, he's pretty easy in terms of what he's looking for. At least that's how the story reads. All right, let's keep going. So we've already started our application. What else can we learn from this?
I think there's some aspect of envy that's in here. You know, you look at the story of you know, somebody who's really successful and be given more. You know, how do we respond to that? Do we say, you know, what a good, gracious God? Or do we say, hey, you know, he got too much, or he got more than I did?
Mm-hmm. So there's a possibility for envy. How does this correct it? Because you could be envious. Like the guy with the one could have said, well, wait a minute. He already got 10.
If your heart is full of envy, you're gonna bury the good that you could do.
Yeah. And why is the envy really inappropriate?
Because God is gracious at all.
Because he could have taken his talent to the bank. He has no reason to be envious. I mean, he could be, right? He could be very envious. How come that guy gets 11? Well, there's an answer. Because you took your one and you didn't take it to the bank, at least. You could have doubled it. That would have been nice. But the least you could have done is take it and invest it with money. And at my coming, I should receive what was my own with interest. Because here's the next question. Whose is the interest? Still the master's. But it's also what was expected from the servant. That's that vague. It's like we're going to, in some ways, there's a little bit of profit sharing. Can I get that right, Rob? A little profit sharing going on here?
Yeah, that's right.
Here we go. All right, what else can we learn from this?
Well, you said this a minute ago, both the one that got 5 talents and the one that got 2 talents, they both got the same response from the master, that well done, good and faithful servant. So
mm-hmm.
It really doesn't matter what you do with it, just do something with it.
Yeah, and something in proportion to what you've been given.
Right.
All right. You want to say something, Sue?
Well, I was just going to say that we say that it all belongs to the master. But yet he shares, because in 29, it says, whoever has more will be given and he will have abundance. So he gives us for us also.
Yeah.
He gives it to us to have abundance.
Right.
So he shares with us in a way.
Yep. What does your verse 14 say? Mine was different than the one Sam read. How does it start?
For the kingdom of heaven.
Okay, so mine says for it. Different, again, different translation, different rendering. For it will be.
Oh, okay.
Okay. This is a parable of the kingdom, right? So it's a story about a kingdom, about a master and servants, but it's teaching us about the kingdom. So what does this teach us about the kingdom?
Like a man traveling to a far country.
Okay, so part of our journey to the kingdom is we work for a master who is at least physically absent.
Mm-hmm. And that's true with our relationship with God.
Yeah, we don't see him,
mm-hmm.
right? In what sense does the master not leave? Obviously, physically, he leaves. In what sense does he not leave? What remains with the servants?
The talents.
Right. So there's something about what is his that still makes him, in some sense, present. And mainly, at least in this story, with what he's entrusting to them, which is his, remains his. The results are going to be his, but as we said, the master's going to share that with the servants. In some ways, he remains with them in what's his.
There's another way too, and that is his reputation or his teaching.
Yeah, specifically about what?
Well,
what's he expect of them? What's his expectation?
Work.
Yeah. Yeah, they're supposed to work based on what he gave them, entrusted to them. They're expected to do something. Now he's pretty vague in what he expects, and he finds acceptable what would have been the interest on the one. But yes, there's a teaching, and as we said all along through Matthew, it's not just a teaching on what is true and what is false. It's how do you live? So there's a teaching that they're supposed to follow here that says, take what you've been given, do something with it, right? And the implication is not that he said, figure it out on your own, right? They're servants. They've had some level of training from the master. It says, okay, now I'm leaving. When I come back, I want to see what you've done with it.
You know, Father, this reminds me a little bit of our Sunday school class that Charlie did last week, where Father David came in and was talking about the different vestments.
Mm-hmm.
And when he came to putting on the cuffs, he talked about a comment that Bishop Anthony had said about the fact that when he gets to that point, he realizes that his hands are not his own. And I thought that was so powerful.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's totally looking at his service as being that mediator to do God's work.
Yeah.
Not his hands anymore, it's God's hands.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And when you think of cuffs, we don't use cuffs anymore separate from a shirt. But if you were going to imagine me putting on cuffs of any kind, what does it remind you of? Where else do you see people putting things on their wrists?
A warrior.
Could be a shield, right?
Yeah.
And if you're a warrior, you fight for the general. What's that, Sam?
Bondage?
Yeah. Right? Handcuffs.
Oh.
Manacles. Right? Because you're binding the hands to say, you now do what I allow you to do and nothing more. So in the soldier, you've more freedom, obviously. With the prisoner, you're bound because now you're mine.
But there's the thought of the, you know, I'm going to cuff you. Does it mean you're going to have that? I always thought that it meant like somebody's going to smack you.
Like a shield, you mean?
Yeah, they've got there and they're going to smack. I'm going to cuff you.
Right. So when you have that, a soldier has it. He's a soldier in the army. He's not going to, where should I go fight today?
Right.
General tells him, you go there, you do this. Right?
The wandering
warrior. Right? Exactly. The wandering warrior dies.
I find it interesting to note that he allows the 5 and the 10 talent men to keep their ability to do things, but the one that is cast out, he has no ability to do anything anymore.
That's right. Because what was his goal? What was that servant with the one talent? What was his goal?
That he wasn't going to lose the talent. The
status quo.
Yeah. Do what he thought would have been good. Well, at least I give him his one back, I'm okay.
Mm-hmm.
As long as I give him what I got, I'll be okay. And that was his mistake. Because the master said, yeah, but you didn't, at least you could have made me interest. In other words, he's ignored the fact that he is the servant. He said, I'm going to do this my way. I'm going to produce what I think is enough, and the master better take it. Well, the master said, guess what? You don't decide these things. I decide. And this is where I think, you know, Alan, you said the word mean. There is a hardness that some people could attribute to God that can sound mean, but is it really mean? Is it so mean that the master expects the person to at least make a little interest? Is it so mean in the teaching for God to tell us, do something with what I gave you. Don't just give me back what I gave you, because then we're giving him what? If we just give God what he gave us,
nothing.
He's saying to us, nothing is acceptable. Giving me but nothing back, which I gave you the one. If you give it back to me, I've gained nothing. So is that mean for God to say that to us?
No, because it's all, as we all already understand, we're talking about what God has given us in our own lives. And if we just, you know, just make sure that we just stay in this tight little border and we haven't, you know, in some cases that will be enough. and others, it's not going to be enough. And we have to step out of our comfort zone at some point to help somebody else or assist in something.
Yeah, because there's fear. This servant had fear. He was afraid he would lose.
I don't think the man was wicked. I mean, he may have been lazy, but wicked is pretty attacking to that guy.
Is that what he calls him in your translation?
Yeah, wicked.
Yeah. So we could say, well, that's not wicked. God is saying when we're lazy, we're wicked. We don't produce that increase.
Go ahead. Well, we could say burying the talent.
Rick and Susan's phone.
Okay. We could say that burying the talent, I just see some contempt in that action.
Yeah, although not in the view of the servant. He doesn't think he has any contempt. He says, I'm being safe. I'm a little afraid. Master's a hard man. I'm going to play this safe. But in playing it safe, he was actually in contempt of them because the master said, go make me some money. So we're starting to see, which I think is one of the crucial meanings of this parable. Remember, this is coming after, and it's the last parable. We can keep thinking that we're going to define what is right and true and just. God has his own definition, and our choice is, are we going to choose? Are we going to accept his definition of things, his expectations? Are we say, well, I'm afraid, I'm not going to do anything, and that's good enough. And that's where yours says wicked, mine says worthless servant. I like my translation better.
Yeah, worthless would be a good, yeah, I do too.
But it's worthless, it's wicked because it's worthless, right? We like to think of wicked as that which is easily condemnable, like that person stole, they're wicked.
That would have been, if he took the talent, he didn't lose any of it.
He
made a mistake.
But God is saying, when you are lazy, when you give me nothing more than what I gave you, you are worthless, and because you're worthless, you're wicked.
So he second-guessed God.
Yes.
He didn't follow what he told him
to do. He redefined what wicked was. He said, well, this is not wicked. I'm going to bury my talent, and I'll give it back, and everything's good. He defined for himself. Now, remember, go back over the story. If you look at how everyone's encountered Jesus, most of them are, when they encounter him, rewriting or retelling Jesus who he is. Right? Remember, you cast out demons by Beelzebul and the prince of demons. They're going to keep trying to tell him, and they're telling themselves who he is. And now we're going to see what the result is going to be. Because they're going to be so contemptuous of him that they're going to kill him. They're going to try him in a mock trial, a kangaroo court. They're going to torture him, and they're going to kill him. Why? Because he doesn't fit their definition of what they expect from God.
Father, let me read the footnote on here.
Please.
The wicked and lazy servant could not evade responsibility for ignoring his talent. We are stewards of every gift, using each for our own and our neighbor's salvation. Idleness is a reunification of God's grace as well as a lack of love for God and humanity. Since people are managers or stewards of God's gifts, each of us will give account of how we used the abundance of gifts given to us.
Beautiful. And you'll notice there, he doesn't define, whoever wrote the footnote, doesn't define what that gift is.
Yeah.
So is it money? Sure. Is it abilities? Sure. Is it time? Sure. Is it personality? Sure. There's no limitation on what it is. What it's clear, though, is everything we have comes from God.
The final sentence in, it says, since help was available to him in the church, the man has no excuse.
Right. Because remember, it's a parable of the kingdom. I want to read you one quote that we got to go. We're out of time, but we were talking. Sue mentioned that significant about the fact that he buries in the earth. This is St. Gregory the Great. He says, but the person who received one talent went away, dug in the earth, and hid his master's money. Hiding a talent in the earth means employing one's abilities in earthly affairs, failing to seek spiritual profit, never raising one's heart from earthly thoughts. There are some who have received the gift of understanding, but have a taste only for things that pertain to the body. The prophet says of them, quote, they are wise in doing evil, but they do not know how to do good.
That's good.
Yeah. And really, if you think about this being a culmination of the teaching of Christ and Matthew, we've talked so much about the importance of the spiritual over and above the physical. And again, going into 26 and thereafter, we're going to see the physical of Jesus, his physical suffering, crucifixion, as bad as it is worth doing because of the eternal benefits in the kingdom.
And this is right before he's going to be crucified. He's got to get this message out because it's those people that he's preaching to that will have to carry on.
That's right. Yeah, that's a great point, because you could say that he could take this opportunity to teach forward in the sense, okay, you're going to see me crucified. Here's why I'm doing it. Here's what it means. He's done that a couple times already. But you're right. His last chance to really teach, he's saying, you've been given. You've been given very amounts, but you've been given something. I'm not going to be around forever. I'm going to be gone. But you have work to do. And so when we think about Matthew's gospel, especially when we get to the end of the book, at the end of chapter 28, we're going to see how all of this comes together in terms of what Matthew tells us Jesus is expecting of the disciples specifically, but I think by implication, all of us. And it's going to end with him going away. All right. Well, thanks, everybody. Good to be with you all.
Father, could you just wrap this parable up in one or two sentences, or is that kind of what you just did?
Mainly that, yeah. It's be prepared, as we heard in the last one. The master's coming back when later than we expect, and in a way where expecting something we may not think is important. But our job is not to second-guess him and say, well, we think we should do this. It's saying, what has he told us to do? Do. Do it and do what we can do. All right, quick. Let's see. We are here next week, I believe, or not. Let's see.
I'm not. The 7th.
Right, I gotta see.
When do you go to Austin?
That's what I'm trying to figure out. Stop the recording here.
Brittany's gone.